the modern world offers us the best of things. We have best products available, we have shopping malls coming up, incomes are going up, and we're driving around in fancy cars. But the downside of it, the flip side, is that there is a disturbing trend in factors such as this. Marriages are breaking at an alarming pace, there is substance abuse, there is suicide, crime rates are going up, and all of this leads to stress. So the question before us is stress a necessary evil that we have to bear with and suffer in the name of development? Or is there a way out? Is there a way in which you can develop economically, financially, technologically, and yet not suffer from stress and the ill effects of development? For this, you need to go back to ancient India, when we were at the zenith of development. We were at the cutting edge technology, we had contributed in the fields of science, technology, art, music, dance, even education. People from all over the world used to converge to India for education, not spiritual of course, but even ordinary secular, so-called secular education. Yet, at the same time, crime rate was unheard of, crime was unheard of. The historians say that there were no such thing as security systems. There were no locks on doors. There were no doors, first of all. There were extended families, society lived in a feeling of oneness, love, secure relationships, and zero stress. Women were safe and free. The question that arises before us is this model something that we can replicate in modern times using the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita and Vedanta? Vedanta says it is a resounding yes. You can have your cake and eat it. How does this happen? Vedanta says, the Bhagavad Gita says, that the key to success, happiness, and growth is samam. Throughout the Gita, he speaks of that. Samatvam yoga uchyate, samadarshanaha. The capacity to remain equanimous in spite of the ups and downs of the world is the prerogative of only the human being. If you look back into development, you find that mammals score over all other creatures because they have the capacity of maintaining a constant body temperature irrespective of what the environment has to offer. It could be freezing cold outside, it could be very, very hot outside in summer. The mammal has the capacity of homeostasis, means same body temperature, right? Once this happens, the energy is, why is it that the mammal scores over, why is it that the mammal has been able to survive all kinds of odds, is because its energies are then released to deal with other more important things. When it comes to the human being, in addition to maintaining a constant body temperature, we also have the ability, and it's a fantastic ability, of maintaining the same mental temperature, samam, in spite of the ups and downs of the world. And this, once you learn this art of not getting ruffled, of remaining equanimous, not succumbing to the pressures of the world, then you become a monarch. You become all-powerful. And this is the goal of human evolution. Unfortunately, we are not exercising this prerogative of ours because we have not been exposed to this knowledge from childhood. In ancient India, along with other knowledge, this was integrated into a child's upbringing in such a way that by the time he or she grew into a full-grown adult, she or he was more than capable of handling life's challenges. Today, we are woefully inadequate in handling life's challenges. The slightest challenge comes along and we succumb to it. We give in without even the slightest fight. What a tragedy that the human being, the best among all creatures. You know, it is said that God was experimenting with creation, started with the unicellular amoeba and this, that and the other, and went along. And then when the human being was created, he stopped right there. You know why? Because the human being was perfection. He couldn't better creation. And yet, it is ironically the human being who is most tormented, most stressed. No other creature in the world is stressed as much as, in fact, no other creature is stressed, period. It's only you and me who are subjected to stress and tension. So therefore, samam is the key. And how to achieve that? In order to understand that, we need to identify what comes in the way. What do you think comes in the way of our maintaining a calm? What disturbs the balance is unbridled desire. Ever increasing levels of desire. And as a result of this desire piling up, the stockpile of desires, like stockpile of nuclear weapons, are extremely dangerous. So this stockpile of desires results in erosion of values. You look at a person, the moment the desires build up, the first thing that is sacrificed is values. So what happens is, your existing desires cannot be fulfilled through ethical, legal, straight methods, and so therefore you cross the line. And when you cross the line, it seems so innocuous, it seems so innocent, and it is perfectly justifiable. You justify it and say, oh, this is the 21st century, we are not in ancient times, and in the modern times we need to adjust and this, that and the other. You cross the line and then it's a slide. You go all the way down. All of this unbridled desire itself causes mental agitation. When you cross your own standard of values, when you violate your own conscience, that leads to tremendous stress. And all this stress leads to negativity, a negative approach to life. And all of this saps you of energy. That's why wherever you look, whoever you meet, everyone is tired, not only in the evening at this time. First thing in the morning, people are tired. They don't sleep well, their physiological functions are on overdrive. See, when there is a dis-ease at the level of the mind, when the mind is in a constant state of agitation and disturbance, it reflects in the physiological functions of your body being in overdrive. So your circulation, your respiration, your digestion, everything goes haywire. And this leads to disease of the body. So there's no use just going to a doctor and taking medicine. What you have to do is tackle the very root, which is the dis-ease in the mind. So how do you deal with all this? Now you knew the answers, but how do you deal with them is the question. For which, let's take, you know, in modern management when they learn this, take case studies. So a case study in philosophy is Sita in the Ramayana. Sita represents the individual you and me. And in the beginning, Sita was perfectly at peace with herself because her focus, her attention was on Rama. Rama represents Atman, the higher. So as long as our attention is on Atman, the higher aspects of life, a higher ideal, something beyond our selfish, self-centered interests, what happens? You are happy, you're independent of the world. It empowers you, it invigorates you, energizes you, and you have a very positive, enthusiastic outlook in life. And that's what happened to Sita. She was completely immune to the world. It didn't matter to her whether she was enjoying the luxury of the Ayodhya palace or going through the rigors of Vanvas. She was totally content with herself because her focus was on Rama. All her problems started, just as all our problems start, when the focus shifts from the higher to selfish, self-centered, personal interest. This is what happened to Sita. This is what happened to Arjuna in the Mahabharata war. The backdrop of the Bhagavad Gita is, here is a mighty warrior, Arjuna, commander-in-chief of the Pandava forces, a brilliant leader who has never lost a battle. He has won, fought and won many, many challenges and battles before. And yet, when it comes to this battle, the most important battle of his life, he buckles. Why does he buckle? He buckles because he looks at the whole thing from a personal perspective. And all his energy, his skills, his power, his vitality, everything deserts. And this is what happens to every one of us. The only difference is, Arjuna just fell into a pothole, as it were. By and large, he was an unselfish person. So he had faced success, and here is an occasion when he caved in. But when it comes to us, we are constantly looking at everything that happens in life from a personal, selfish, self-centered interest. How can you expect to succeed in any field of endeavor? You start an educational institution, the starting point right through your endeavor and the goal is merely to make money. How can you ever succeed? You see, here we are talking about the Gita, and there is in the United States the best universities. You go to any university in America, you'll find a fairly high population of students there. Look, take a look at the faculty. A fairly high degree of the faculty members are also Indian. And then you wonder, so why is it when a large number of Indians go there as students, a large number of Indians go there as faculty members, why can't we start an educational institution here of the same quality or perhaps better? Because we're only looking at everything from a personal perspective, start to finish. And therefore it is that on paper we are winners, but when it comes to action we become paper tigers. Nothing there. Whether it's in the field of cricket or sport or music or art or medicine or anything, any field, we are brilliant, extremely talented, very hardworking, everything A+, except this. And it is this which gets us down. So where we need to focus our attention is on setting aside our selfish interests, setting aside our desires, and then you find this power, the energy that comes back to you. Because you're dissipating your energies in silly, trivial, unimportant things. I think we should do this as an exercise. Just record our conversation one day from morning to night. Play it back to yourself. You yourself find it unbearable to listen to this petty conversation. How many of us focus on something higher? This is the problem. So also with Sita. The moment she entertained a desire, and that desire, her focus shifted from Rama to a silly deer, correct? A golden deer. Golden, tantalizing, attractive. This is what happens to us. Right? You perhaps don't have a desire, and then suddenly you see one big billboard hoarding, advertising something. Flashy, golden, very attractive, very tantalizing. But fleeting, ephemeral. And that object, the deer in the Ramayana, was really not a deer. What was it? a rakshasa. This is what you need to understand. Beware of falling for sense objects because there is a rakshasa lurking there. Now don't go looking for rakshasas. Because it's not what it appears to be. It's not going to give you happiness. All that happens is what happened to Sita. Sita was abducted by Ravana, and every one of us gets abducted by the 10-headed monster, the 10 sense organs. And once you're in the grip of a sense organ, even one, forget 10, you get completely debilitated, you get destroyed by just one weakness. It is tragic to see the fall. You see a person who has a weakness for alcohol till he kills himself, literally kills himself, he doesn't let go. Take a person who has a weakness for cigarettes. Till the thing destroys him completely, he doesn't let go. Take a person who has any weakness. So powerful. And even before, see, the whole Ramayana, the whole story gives us valuable insight into our personality and how to prevent it. Now, even when you fall for sense objects, there are checks and balances within you which prevent you from going completely overboard. But if you disregard those checks and balances, then you're in for trouble. So what are the checks and balances? You all know the story, but we're going through it just for connecting the symbolism. So what happens is, Rama goes, and Rama is more than capable of taking on not one rakshasa, several rakshasas. So he effortlessly shoots the deer, the rakshasa. And as it's dying, that rakshasa lets out a scream, as if and imitating Rama. So when Sita heard the sound, this is what happens. It's not just the weakness for one sense object. What happens is that it clouds your intellect. And that intellect, which has the wisdom, has the knowledge, has the ability to decipher things, loses this, loses the clarity. And Sita thought that Rama was in trouble. How do we know that her intellect has got clouded? Because Lakshmana also heard the same sound. But his intellect was clear, unclouded. And he knew that it was impossible that Ram could get into trouble. And he followed Rama's orders. Rama's orders were, take care of Sita. Because even when Ram went, he knew that there was something more than what met the eye. And he was concerned about Sita, because Sita was the only weak link in this entire scenario. So he told Lakshmana, whatever you do, don't leave her unguarded. And he wasn't prepared to go. But because her intellect got clouded and she suddenly panicked because she thought that Ram was in trouble, she sent Lakshmana away. He had no choice but to follow her orders, because eventually she was the boss. But in doing so, these are the checks and balances. In doing so, he drew three lines. These three lines are the famous Lakshman Rekha. He says, whatever you do, don't cross this line. Don't cross these three lines. She said yes. But as we say, once your intellect gets clouded, you commit a series of mistakes. Say, spot wherever you are in trouble and trace the happenings. You'll find that you've committed a series of mistakes and landed up in so much trouble that you find it difficult to extricate yourself. This is where the depression sets in, because you feel it's a hopeless situation. But the Gita tells us, Vedanta tells us, nothing is a hopeless situation. Every situation has a solution. Every problem has a solution, an answer. And that's what gives us this tremendous courage. In the Gita, he says, you could be the most sinful person on God's earth, but there is a way out for you. So when you understand that, you know how to trace back. So coming back to Sita, Then Ravana appeared in disguise. So this is what happens. It's not that Ravana has appeared in disguise. It's that your vision completely gets mucked up, messed up. So you see things which are not there. Like for instance, when you're overcome with a desire, you see a benefactor as a villain. And you see a villain as a benefactor. Because what is the villain doing? The villain is promoting your weakness. What is the benefactor doing? Trying to protect you. You don't like it. So, Ravana appears as a mendicant and asks for alms. And she goes back to collect whatever it is. She's about to give it to him. And he lures her out of that Lakshman Rekha, which, in spite of Lakshmana telling her repeatedly, don't cross this line, she crosses the line. This is what we all do. The Lakshman Rekha is for intelligent people. It is self-imposed discipline, where your intellect, your conscience decides that I will go this far and no further. But in society where people don't have the ability or don't have a powerful enough intellect to put the checks and balances on themselves, society does it. But as a person who's completely overcome by desire doesn't take heed of any of this, she crosses the line and is abducted by Ravana. Even after this happens, there is still a way out. When she's taken to Lanka and Ravana offers her the earth, says you can be a queen, you get pride of place here, at least then she wakes up. She wakes up to her predicament, she wakes up to the mistakes that she's committed and decides that no, I'm not going to go any further with this. At least at this stage, and we are all at this stage, we're all at this stage where we have been abducted by our own 10 sense organs, our own weaknesses have overcome us. At least at this stage we must say, no, I will not go any further. Step back, look within. And she refuses to leave what is known as the Ashoka Vanam, outside of Lanka, outside the palace. She stays in a place which is Ashoka. Shoka, sorrow, Ashoka, non-sorrow. Constantly contemplating on Ram. So if this much we are able to achieve, which we hope, the very fact that you've come here, today is the third day, and tomorrow is the last day. Perhaps from long distances, some of you I know have come from long distances to come here. Let's hope that at the end of tomorrow's session, we will go back with at least enough conviction to remain in the Ashoka Vanam. So when you refuse to indulge any further in the world and all that the world has to offer, you are in a state of non-sorrow. You don't have the bliss of realization yet. You haven't yet united with Rama yet, as Sita. But you are in contemplation of Atman, and in this contemplation of the higher, you are protected from the sorrows, the knocks and shocks of the world. And when you continue like this consistently, Hanuman appears. Now don't go and buy the, what is that, DVD of Hanuman and wait for a person like Hanuman to appear. Hanuman means, Hanuman comes. Hanuman is an emissary of Ram. And when he's going to Lanka, he says, how will Sita recognize me? She'll think that I'm also part of Ravana's trickery to lure her away. So Rama gives her Hanuman his ring and says, you show this ring to Sita and she will be sure that you have been sent by me. And that's exactly what Hanuman does. And when he's hiding there and he sees Sita, he is so filled with devotion, because basically Sita is a pure person. And he goes and offers her the ring, and that's when she knows that her liberation is near, Ram is near. This is what happens to each one of us. As you continue on the spiritual path, you find life unfolding. Everything falls in place as if God were saying, don't worry, I'm there. We'll meet soon, shortly. And this is the ring of confidence that you get, and you continue with renewed vigor until the reunion takes place with Ram. So this is not Sita's story, but the story of every one of us. And hopefully, like Sita's story, ours will also end with the reunion with Atman. So what is the way out? When you are overcome with desires, what's the way out? The first thing that we